There is a giant hole in the Arizona desert, 35 miles east of Flagstaff. It's huge, 3/4 of a mile wide and 550 feet deep. The Washington Monument could fit inside it. The mystery confronting geologists in the late 19th century was, how did this happen? People agreed that only a massive force could have created such a huge chasm. But what was this force? The most likely theory was that a huge volcanic explosion had ruptured the rugged landscape. Scientists had discovered similar-sized craters in volcanic areas before. But Grove Gilbert, chief geologist for the U.S. Geological Survey, had another idea, one that came to him after observing craters on the moon through his telescope. He saw similarities between the moon's craters and the mysterious hole in the Arizona desert, leading him to speculate that the Arizona crater might have been caused by an asteroid impact. But this was just a theory. At the time, no one had proven that any crater on Earth had been caused by an asteroid. So in 1892, Gilbert decided to travel to the mysterious Arizona crater.
He wondered if this could have an impact origin or alternatively a volcanic origin. And so he had these two competing hypotheses that he wanted to test.
Gilbert assumed that if the crater was caused by an asteroid, he should find a giant alien rock in the middle of it. But there was none. But he did see what he thought were signs that a volcano might be the cause.
When Gilbert arrived, he realized that this hole in the ground was associated with some volcanic peaks in the distance. You can see them in the background over the rim or beyond the rim of the crater. And so immediately, I think he was prejudiced, if you will, towards a volcanic as opposed to a meteoritic origin.
Not far from the mysterious crater, Gilbert found another similar giant hole. He declared this one as an unusual volcanic crater called a mar. He knew that 4 years before in Japan, scientists had witnessed the formation of a mar after a huge underground explosion of steam. The resulting crater resembled the giant hole Gilbert came across in the Arizona desert.
They are produced when basaltic magma rises through the Earth's crust, encounters groundwater, creating a steam explosion which causes a blast that produces craters like the one over my shoulder.
Intriguingly, the two almost identical craters were only 50 miles apart in the same desert. One was known to have been caused by an underground steam explosion. Because of their close proximity, Gilbert concluded that the mysterious crater was also caused by volcanic activity. In 1896, he published his findings in an influential report, and for the wider geological community, the debate was resolved. But 6 years after Gilbert's findings, American entrepreneur and mining engineer Daniel Barringer arrived on the same scene. He was intrigued by mysterious small iron rocks shepherds had found around the crater while grazing their herds. Barringer was convinced that Gilbert was wrong about the crater's origins.
I'm holding in my hands a fragment of what started it all. It is not the type of material that one finds in any other geologic terrain or created by any terrestrial geologic process.
Iron in rock is usually mixed with other minerals, but at the mysterious crater, the iron was almost pure. And there were large amounts normally not found on the Earth's surface, spread over a huge area surrounding the crater. Barringer believed the pieces found here were meteorites, small space rocks that form when big asteroids break apart. He had a hunch that this huge hole in the desert was formed by a giant asteroid made largely from iron. Barringer immediately saw the commercial opportunities. From the crater's size, he calculated that the asteroid must have weighed 10 million tons. With iron then at $80 a ton, Barringer was convinced he could become a rich man from mining the iron. So in 1903, Barringer bought the crater site of over 1,200 acres and hired crews to begin digging. Convinced it was an impact site, he named it Meteor Crater.
We're in one of the remnants of Barringer's mining camp. This is a place where his miners lived, ate, slept, while they looked for the buried meteoritic mass that they thought was beneath the floor of the crater.
For years, Barringer and his men found only small fragments of iron. Undeterred by this, they kept digging deeper shafts into the earth.
The largest of which, the main shaft, you can see is a white island of debris in the center of the crater. And in fact, one of those holes, close to me here, reached a depth of nearly 1,400 feet beneath the surface of the earth. In all of these cases, or most of these cases, they found telltale hints of the impacting meteoritic body, but no giant mass.
Barringer did stumble across some clues, however. Strange and unique rock formations, such as fine pulverized rock spread around the crater.
He noticed, quite rightly, that it is so fine it is almost like talcum powder, the type of thing that immediately alerted him to something unusual and the geologic processes that shaped the land here.
To Barringer, the pulverized rock was a major clue that pointed to one thing, the violent impact of an asteroid.
As a geologist, if I saw this rock, I would say, okay, this is not something that I see around a volcanic crater. There's something going on here, and I need to figure it out.
Barringer also discovered other oddities. At the crater rim, he noted a bed of rocks that were chaotically overturned.
Dramatic energy uplifted the rocks in the crater wall behind me. Originally, they were absolutely horizontal, and you can see that they are tilted upward. And if you look very closely at the very top of the rim, they are completely overturned.
For 27 years, Daniel Barringer obsessively sunk mining shafts in search of his giant iron asteroid, with no success. Barringer died in 1929, having lost 600,000 of his own and investors' money. 10 million in today's dollars. Meteor Crater in the Arizona desert was still a mystery to the geological community. The debate on whether it was caused by volcanic activity or an asteroid impact wasn't resolved until 1960. A young geologist, Eugene Shoemaker, became interested in Barringer's research. He would take the investigation in a new direction, which turned Meteor Crater into one of the most investigated crater sites on Earth. Shoemaker was working on craters left by nuclear explosions on test sites in Nevada. His task was to find out how the explosions transformed the landscape. Intriguingly, at the test sites, he found the exact same rock formations Barringer had described at the mysterious Meteor Crater in Arizona. Shoemaker passed away in 1997, but his wife, astronomer Carolyn Shoemaker, recalls his findings.
Gene compared Meteor Crater with the craters that he had been mapping at the Nevada test site. At the test site, Gene saw overturned beds also near the top of the craters in the rims. And that certainly told him that there was a strong similarity because they were so obvious at Meteor Crater.
Shoemaker came upon another important clue that linked the Nevada test sites to Meteor Crater.
He found samples of this very unusual rock. This was once sandstone, but he recognized it had been altered.
In the craters left by explosions from nuclear bomb testing, Shoemaker discovered crystalline structures, the same structures found at Arizona's Meteor Crater.
Today we understand that this is shock sandstone glass. That is, the original sandstone, all of the quartz crystals were melted and put into a frothy, bubbly, glassy matrix, which we have here.
They were caused by the incredible energy released in the shock waves of a nuclear blast. Thank you. For Shoemaker, it was conclusive proof that the vast Meteor Crater wasn't formed by volcanic eruptions. Instead, it was created by a powerful asteroid impact in just a split second. The shocked rock also gave scientists a clue about the age of the crater. When an asteroid hits the Earth, the energy from the blast is absorbed by the surrounding rock. Using a process called thermoluminescence dating, scientists are able to measure the amount of energy the rock is giving off in the form of light. The shocked rock from Meteor Crater told them that the impact happened 50,000 years ago. But for some, there remained one problem with this theory. If the Arizona Earth was crushed by a huge asteroid, where was the rock that made the impact? Scientists had a hunch that when it struck, the iron meteorite had vaporized. Conclusive evidence came in 1997, when scientists were able to simulate the impact using advanced computer modeling. From the size of the crater, they calculated that the asteroid must have weighed at least 300,000 tons when it struck. The data further revealed that it hit Earth at a speed of over 25,000 miles per hour. That's 35 times the speed of sound. Upon impact, the asteroid triggered a massive shock wave, many times more powerful than a nuclear explosion.
Within a matter of seconds, the impact crater behind me was excavated and this debris was deposited on the landscape. Within seconds, the shock wave and the very high velocity air blast radiated across the landscape.
The shock wave traveled back up through the asteroid's iron core, vaporizing most of it, and scattering the rest in small pieces over a wide area up to 6 miles away.
The energy that produced this crater ranges somewhere from a few hundred to perhaps 1,000 times greater than the energy that destroyed the cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki in World War II.
The investigation has uncovered reasons why there are no big remnants of asteroid rock in the Arizona crater. Crystalline structures in the rock showed evidence of a strong shockwave that followed the impact. Computer modeling revealed that the speed and size of the asteroid created enough energy for the rock to vaporize when it hit.
This crater is particularly important because it is the youngest and most pristine impact crater on the surface of the Earth. It was also the first recognized impact crater on the surface of the Earth, and so it is in some sense the Rosetta Stone. It is the touchstone for geology. It is here that specialists from around the world come to study and learn about impact cratering as a geologic process.